Hi, I'm Virginia Spielman. I'm the Executive Director here at STAR Institute for SPD in Denver, Colorado. And as you can see, today I'm here with our esteemed founder and Director Emeritus,
Dr. Lucy Jane Miller.
And so today we're going to be talking more about sensory processing and integration as part of our Sensory Awareness Month series. It's episode 3, and we're going to really be looking at and discussing sensory modulation. So I wonder if you could just introduce us to what this means.
I think just simply, you can think of sensory modulation as regulation. It's the ability to regulate the sensory information that comes in from the environment. The information comes into your brain processes it, and then you respond. It's as simple as that. It can be also very technical and very complex. But I think for our purposes, understanding that it's the response to sensory information is what counts.
So how we respond to events in the environment around us and inside our bodies.
Yes.
And the degree to which we respond to them.
Exactly.
And so what are some, I know there are different subtypes in mm-hmm. sensory modulation. There are different sort of patterns that emerge. Can you describe those?
Sure, of course. We've been studying this for 25, 30 years now, and we've gotten a pretty good idea of both the physiology underlying it and what the responses are. And I think what's really important is for people to realize that their different subtypes make children look, and adults, look very different. So if you're over-responsive, you respond too much, too fast, or for too long a duration. But if you're under-responsive, it's the opposite. You respond too little, not for a long duration, and not with much intensity. And those two things look completely different, as you can imagine. Over-responsive, that's over-responsive. Under-responsive, they almost look apathetic, like they're not into it at all. And the third type is called sensory craving, where you just are insatiable and you can't get enough jumping, or you can't get enough pulling on your mom in the store, or any kind of sensory input. The music is too loud. Everything is more than a typical person would want.
And so that's different to under-responsivity and over-responsivity because of the insatiable component to it. So you seek and you seek and you seek the input, but you never get organized from
it. Exactly. That's right. Over or under is a threshold issue. So if you're over-responsive, you respond too soon. Let's say this is normal. Over-responsive, your threshold is too low. And so when the information comes in, wham, your sensory gate opens and you respond. Under-responsive, you respond too late. It takes all this input until the gate opens up, the sensory gate, and you feel it and you experience it. But sensory craving isn't a threshold issue. It's a different type of issue. And so it should not be thought of in the same way as you would help or fix it by pouring sensation into that child. That will only make them wild and crazy.
So it's really interesting to me to think about the fact that even just within this category that we're talking about, which is modulation, and we've already talked about posture and motor-based challenges and difficulties, we've already talked about discrimination. This is a whole separate category. And yet within this, we should be able to identify detail about what's going on with each child rather than just saying it's a sensory modulation issue.
And not only that, there are 8 sensory systems.
Right.
So you can be over-responsive to touch, but you can be under-responsive to sound. And so it's very complex when you really think about all the things that have to go into a differential diagnosis or an accurate diagnosis.
Yeah, an accurate diagnosis rather than just sort of a blanket statement. And that's why we need well-trained multidisciplinary teams who know what
exactly.
They're talking about.
And we need really good objective measures that will allow us to measure the things in every sensory system.
Right, right. And there's some really great work coming out about that soon,
right.
That we're excited about.
Yes.
So you said something really interesting to me. You said, you know, sensory under-responsive looks one way, sensory over-responsive looks the other way. Can you talk about, you know, what people might see and think of as misbehavior or challenging behaviors, but actually could be sensory at the root?
Actually, that's the whole problem. People think it's behavior.
Mm.
It looks like behavior because you can't see sensory. You can't somebody over responds to sensation, they don't over respond with a sensory export. They over respond with the behavior. The behavior will be covering their ears, or could be smacking another kid, or don't touch me. That's a behavioral response. Sometimes there's a motor response. Sometimes the child is clumsy and awkward in response to sensation. But with modulation, it's most frequently a behavior response, and people will say he's lazy, or he's hyper, or
right,
or he's like, he won't let me touch him. He just gets into, he has a temper tantrums all the time. So people don't come here for sensory therapy. They come here to help their children modulate their behavior or regulate their behavior in response to sensation. So the trick is looking at it as a sensory problem, not looking at it as a behavior problem. Time out is not going to fix the problem.
So we see the behavior and we think sensory, and we look at what's the behavior communicating to us about how this child is responding to their environment and the internal sensations of their body.
It's sort of like you have to put on your sensory lens.
Mm-hmm.
You have one lens that's sensory and one lens that's behavioral, and if you don't have both lenses, you're not going to get a fused picture of what the child is really made up of.
Nice. How might it look in adulthood if you're having challenges with sensory modulation and maybe no one's ever identified that with you before?
It's very complex with adults, because by the time you're an adult, your emotions are hardwired in with your sensations.
Mm-hmm.
So your brain puts them together. And so when you feel depressed, or when you feel anxious, or when you feel like you have to run around or get things done, you feel overwhelmed, that is probably an emotional response, but it could have a sensory origin.
Mm.
Now, it might not have a sensory origin. So some OTs think everything is sensory.
Mm-hmm.
And to some extent it is, because sensory and emotion are processed in the same part of your brain, but to some extent it's not. And so you need a very well-trained OT, usually working with a clinical psychologist or a master's in social work, a person who's trained in mental health,
mm-hmm.
to try to parse out what the problem actually is, and then what do you do about it? That's a whole other subject.
Right. And then, I mean, certainly what we're saying here and now is that that sensory piece has to at least be considered. It should be at the table all the way through the lifespan. And this over-responsive or under-responsive.
And really, it should be tested.
Right.
Right. Not just considered, but an adult could respond to a strobe light. They could respond to a touch. They could respond to something moving in space. And if they don't have an abnormal response, then those behaviors that you see are psychological. They're not sensory. So until we have good ways of testing children, adolescents, and adults to find out if their sensory systems are typical, then it's very hard. You're just guessing.
But wherever possible, start with an evaluation and get some hard data.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Preferably by somebody who's trained in different ways. So you might have an OT and a mental health, a speech language, and a psychologist. You need a team,
mm-hmm.
a village. We always say it takes a village.
Great. Well, that was really great to have that conversation with you. And thank you so much for making the time for this today. And I hope that it was beneficial for you too. As you know, we're really interested in sharing this information as much as we can around the world. And so at the moment, we've just launched Project 2.4 Billion, where we want to get this information translated into different languages and reach that many more people, not just the English speakers. And so click on the link below so you can find out more about that, and we'll see you soon.
Okie doke.